Hello everyone and welcome to another how-to video. My name is Oliver Draper, CTO for COP. And the product we're gonna look at today is the Hikvision IDS 7 Series ANPR camera. This is it right here. So as I said, it's an ANPR camera, so that's automatic number plate recognition. This is the 7-line one, and it's a deep in-view camera, meaning it's got deep learning in there, so that's a form of AI. The benefit of this camera with the fact it's got that deep learning AI in there, you don't get the false alarms simply because the camera recognizes a vehicle in the scene first before actually trying to take a plate read. So if someone actually walks into the scene holding a license plate, the camera knows, well, you're not a vehicle, you're a person, therefore it won't take the plate read. It also means when it's looking for a plate, it's looking for what it believes to be a license plate, which conforms to usual standards, meaning it won't read bumper stickers or signs on the side of vehicles, which you would have get on the older systems. This ANPR camera does have a ton of outputs and inputs on the back of this thing, as you can see there by the mounting of cables coming out the back. Yes, you have got your normal RJ45 port there, obviously for the network. We've got things such as the audio in, audio output. We've got our RS485. We've got our alarm inputs. We've got our alarm outputs. We've got Wigan connection as well, so you can connect in third-party readers in there. 12-volt input to actually power the camera independently, separate to the PoE. It's even got a 12-volt, 1-amp output as well, so if you wanted to put in a separate device nearby to the camera, which would run on 12-volt, 1-amp, you can actually do that from this camera. Just on that lead, just there. So this thing is fully loaded. As I mentioned, it is an ANPR camera. Also has a built-in heater as well, so that can disperse things like ice and snow that may gather up on this in obviously in poor weather conditions. Also, the heater in there helps actually disperse water droplets on there as well when you've got inclement weather as well. Couldn't get my words out then. Also, the fact as well, it's also got the Y end of the product code. We'll look at the product code shortly. But the Y in the product code means it's got an anti-corrosion layer on there as well. So again, it can deal with sort of poor weather environments in salt, so like salt, water in the air. So if you're near the coastal environment, things of that sort of nature. So what we'll do, we'll get this thing installed, get it mounted outside, and we'll log into it and just see how we configure an ANPR camera to get the most accurate reads. So I'm on the web browser for the camera now. What I've done, I've already activated the camera by giving it a password. I'm sure most of you know how to do that using that SADP tool. And I've also given it an IP address so it can talk on my local network. So I'm just going to log in with the settings that I've already predefined, which is simply the username and password. Everything else on the camera is in default standard. So just log in there, should get the live view up. And there we go, the camera is pointing towards our main gate currently. So what I need to do is go into configuration first of all, and we're going to look at the settings in the camera. So straight away we're into the system settings. We can see the product code there. So it's an IDS. I just means it's got intelligence in there because it's deep learning product. DS, high vision product. 2CD, IP camera. 7 means in 7 series. A is a bullet camera. 2 is 2 megapixels. 6 means it's got dark fighter. G0 is the first generation of this particular type of camera. Slash P indicates it's for plate, i.e. it's an ANPR camera, dash IZHS. So I means it's got IR, Z is motorized varifocal lens, H means it's got a built-in heater interface, S means it's also got the interface for audio and alarm input-output, and the Y indicates it's an anti-corrosion camera, so it's got an anti-corrosion layer on there. When we say anti-corrosion, according to the data sheet that Hikvision launched, it means it can be stored it has to be at least 1.5 kilometers away from the coastline. So it will deal with salt water in the air and things of that sort of nature, but it cannot deal with salt water waves crashing onto the camera and things like that. It can't quite do that. It won't be rated to that sort of nature. If you look across the top, we've got things such as our time settings, our daylight saving, RS232 if you are using the 232 port, RS485 if you're using that, metadata settings. As we can see, it's getting the metadata from road traffic. Here is our Wigan connection. So if you're using Wigan, that means you can connect a third-party reader into there. And about just tells us the open source licenses, which we don't need to look at today. I'm not going to go through all the settings because, again, most of these are pretty much similar on all particular IP cameras, which I'm sure you've seen many a times. So we're going to go to the main important ones. Next one we're going to pay attention to is potentially network. Let's take a look at network. Yep, the general networking settings to get on the network. Again, most of that should be as it should be. Advanced settings. Again, main things we're looking at there is, for example, our platform access. If you're going to put it on the HikeConnect, obviously that's in the HikeConnect section there. And then we're going to go to our video and audio on the left-hand side. So our video and audio settings, as we can see there on the main stream,
Its video type is video and audio, if you are going to put an independent microphone in there. Resolution is 1080p. Bitrate type is variable, which is fine. Video quality is set to medium. That's okay for the time being. 25 frames per second. Maximum bitrate is 4 meg. Doesn't mean it's always going to run at 4 meg. Because we've got variable bitrate, the bitrate's going to change depending on how busy the scene actually is. But 4 meg is a maximum you'll ever go to. 265 encoding, which is fine. The plus, again, we never really use that. So that's all fine from a normal conventional IP camera side of things. Now, we do need to go to the image settings on an ANPR camera. Most of the settings in there, because it's in ANPR mode, will be set to a rough sort of idea of what you'd actually need. However, you should never bypass the image settings, especially with ANPR cameras, because we do need to tweak it depending on how our scene is going to behave. So first thing we're going to look at is our exposure settings, one of the most important settings when it comes to ANPR. Iris mode is set to auto, or you can have fixed or generic P-Iris. So that's all to do with basically the depth of field and of what we're going to be seeing in there. Auto should be absolutely fine for today. It's not going to make any major differences. The key one here we're interested in, though, is exposure time. So exposure time is not just shutter speed. Technically, when we talk about exposure time, that's to do with the iris, and it's also to do with the shutter speed as well. So exposure plays a big part, as we see it's under exposure settings. Exposure time, though, is about the actual shutter speed, so that shutter opening and closing on the front of the camera. So what do we mean by exposure? Well, this is all to do how long the shutter is open for. So if a shutter is open for longer, it's going to capture more light. But the downside of that is any fast-moving objects will appear blurred. So then we do a reduced exposure time where the shutter is open and closing quite quickly. That means we're going to get a sharper object, but we're not going to capture as much light. If you think to your Victorian photographs that you see, usually they're sat down in a chair, usually got sort of a stern look on their face. That was because the Victorian cameras obviously needed a long exposure. Usually the subjects had to sit there for at least 5 minutes because the film in the back that the light was burning into took a long time to actually burn the image in there. So again, a 5 minute exposure time. You wouldn't really sit there or stand up, should I say, for 5 minutes with a grin on your face, your jaw's going to ache and so forth. So usually you see them sat down in a stern face because they have to remain perfectly still. So with a long exposure, yeah, more light. But if you move, a blurred object. So we need to bear that in mind. Now with this one here, by default, it is set to 1/1000. Your normal IP cameras might be set to 1/25, meaning that that shutter is opening for 25th of a second. This one's set to 1/1000, meaning the shutter is opening and closing 1/1000th of a second each time. So again, that's quite ideal for most scenarios. If my objects are moving faster, I may need to reduce exposure time to 1/1000 or maybe even 1/100,000. Again, I am going to get a darker scene, as we can see there, but I'll get extremely sharp objects. Now, you wouldn't put it as low as possible in all situations. It's dependent on the speed of vehicle. So this is something you need to decide. How fast your vehicle is going in the scene is going to determine what you set your exposure to. Don't forget, if you have 1/25, yes, really bright scene, really colourful at nighttime, you're not going to get any plate hits unless the vehicle decides to remain perfectly stationary within the area where the plate is going to be. So 1/1000 should be fine for our scenario. As you can see, it's just the gate that people are driving through. Gain. What is gain? Well, gain control is all to do with the brightness of the amplification we see on the image itself. So when you amplify the gain, you're going to get a brighter image. Great, fantastic. However, when you introduce gain onto the scene, not only are you amplifying the light you're seeing, you will amplify and introduce noise onto the scene. So you'll get bits of static and bits of dots appearing there, especially at nighttime when it's in black and white mode. Now, on a normal IP camera, yes, we increase the gain to 100% because we want to get a bright image as possible. So how do we combat the noise that we've introduced in the scene? Well, usually we use something called DNR, digital noise reduction. So essentially with DNR, when you've not got a lot of DNR, you get lots of static that appears in the scene. So we increase the digital noise reduction. And in very basic concepts, what that does, it does pixel correction. So what it will do in a nighttime scene and one you're seeing on your screen there at the minute, what you'll have is you'll have a noisy scene and it will see a pixel in the corner going in the frames, black, 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 white, black, black, white, and so on. And it goes, well, that pixel shouldn't be changed to white as often as it should be doing. So I'll correct it and keep it to black. And vice versa with the areas. So when you turn on DNR, it looks like a nice, cleaner image. Problem, though. With faster moving objects, Bearing in mind, the pixels will be changing as the object moves across the scene. The camera looks at that and goes, oh, the pixels are changing, they shouldn't be. I'm going to correct it and keep it to what it was. And by doing so, that will cause a ghosting effect on fast-moving objects. Well, this is a camera specifically designed for the purposes of actually capturing a license plate on a moving vehicle. So we don't want any ghosting. If you think about it, if that license plate is blurred or ghosted anyway, the algorithm will not be able to read those characters. So we cannot have any ghosting to take place. So we know we can't really play with DNR. Because we can't play with the DNR settings, that does mean we cannot increase the gain past 20 because we can't introduce static in the scene because we can't combat the static in the long run. Other settings we have there, we have our focus settings. Semi-auto is absolutely fine for this sort of scene. That's usually the best one we go with. You can set it to manual, meaning what it will do, you'll have your manual focal point that you will focus on there if you know exactly where the plate is going to be and the focal point is going to be. So if you chose to have a car parked in the scene there where you want your plate hit to be, you could go to manual if you want to. You've just got to bear in mind it will never adjust it. If you go full auto on your focus, that could cause you problems because what the camera will try and do, it will pick up the target object in the distance and try to continuously focus on that object and keep it in sharp focus up until the point of triggering it. If the vehicle is going too fast, can the camera focus in time? Maybe not, and therefore you get your missed plate read. So semi-auto is usually the best one to go for through testing from what we've seen. Day and night switch. Okay, so the day and night switch is altered to that ICR, that infrared cut filter removable. So this is where the camera changes from day mode to night mode. So on a normal conventional camera, it's set to auto, meaning it's going to automatically change from day mode to night mode when the light levels in the scene drop. Okay, or we could put it in permanent day, permanent night. Put it in permanent day, you're going to struggle at night time. Obviously, you're not going to be able to see the light hit, plate hits. Night time, well, you don't want it to be in permanent black and white mode anyway. Scheduled switch, not really applicable for an ANPR camera, especially in the areas of the world we live in the UK. Our day and night changes throughout the year, so not really appropriate. Triggered by alarm input, that is a possible setting you could use. Sort of a legacy way to use it. So if you had a third-party detector to detect the vehicle, might be an induction loop in the road, you could use the induction loop to send a command to the camera to tell it to actually switch from day mode to night mode if you wanted to. But again, with the algorithms now, we don't really need to do it. What we're going to go with instead is triggered by video. This is a little bit like the auto setting. So auto means it's using the light that's in the scene, judging the photo resistance in the scene, and determining when to change the camera over. Triggered by video, however, is not only taking into account the light levels that are in the scene, but actually what the camera's image looks like on the screen that we're seeing at this end. So again, don't forget, we've actually reduced exposure time right down. So that means that when it gets to dusk, this is going to be a really dark scene and the camera's going, actually, you know what? I need to flick to black and white mode. If it was in auto, it would go, oh, whilst the image on the screen we're looking at here looks quite dark, from what the camera's front end is seeing, it goes, well, actually, you know what? I don't need to change over just yet. But that can cause us problems with not getting the plate reads because, again, we need to be actually in a black and white mode there. Sensitivity is judging the photo resistance in the scene, determine how much loss of light is there before it changes over. Most people will increase that to 7, meaning they want to keep it in colour for as long as possible. Don't forget, this is not a surveillance camera. It is an ANPR camera. It's designed to capture plates. That is all we're interested in, essentially. So, you know what? Keeping it in 4 is absolutely fine. If you wanted to keep it and put it to 7 so you get a really bright image later on, you could do, but it's not going to have too much bearing because it is still being triggered by the video. Filtering time is the time it takes to change over, so 5 seconds is the minimum. Smart supplement light. So this is all to do with the IR that we've got in the camera. So IR is the type of supplement light we've got in here. Now, conventional IR acts like a light switch. It's either on or it's off. Smart supplement light, however, acts like a light dimmer switch, and that will dim down the intensity of the IR depending on how close or how far away an object actually is. So what you don't want to do is overexpose your target with too much IR when it's quite close up, because that way you're going to have an overexposed target. At the same way, you don't want too little IR because you will not see the plate in the distance. So smart supplement light is sort of a good one to turn on. It will automatically adjust the amount of IR it's putting onto the scene depending on how close or how far away an object actually is. And then we come on to backlight settings. Now there's 3 settings here. B BLC, WDR, and HLC. I've already done a previous video about actual backlight settings and how to use these ones. If you go to the top right-hand corner, there's a little tab there at the top. Click on that. It'll send you to my other video. That'll tell you how these settings actually work. But essentially, there's two settings here that we'd never use. You would never use BLC, and you would never use WDR on an AMPR camera. Bearing in mind with BLC, that doesn't dynamically adjust the area in the scene. So again, it's going to cause overexposure areas in different places in daytime and nighttime. And when sun changes and headlights and things, it's going to cause us a world of problems. WDR. We would never use WDR on a AMPR camera. Now, as I discussed in my previous video, with WDR works, it takes a long exposure and a short exposure, and then it overlays them. So it takes more light of the darker areas and takes less light of the bright areas and merges them together. And you get a nice balanced exposure. It looks quite nice. However, WDR, it will cause a ghosting effect on fast moving objects. Because think about it. You've got one image with the exposure reduced right down, which gives you a nice sharp object. But then you've got a long exposure of that blurred object, and then it's overlaid. So it looks like a ghosting effect. Again, don't forget, this is an algorithm trying to read numbers and letters and text on a scene. If it cannot read that in a sharp context and looks blurry, the system will not understand that plate and you will not get the plate read. One setting we can use, though, is HLC. This is a setting that came out on the 7 series AMPR cameras. Wasn't available on the older 4 lines. Now, what HLC does, this is a highlight constraint. This will simply dim down the brightness of any strong light sources in the scene and shouldn't really affect our daytime or nighttime scene with regards to AMPR. So I can turn an HLC on, and what that will do is just simply dim down the intensity of any bright light in the scene. Now, this is a particularly useful setting. I mean, straight away you can see the image has got a little bit better. We're not overexposed to the road area where the sunlight is. This is very useful for at nighttime. So when a car drives towards us with its headlights turned on, what that will do is it will dim down the intensity of the strong headlights at the front of the vehicle, ensuring we can see the license plate so it won't be overexposed, as you're seeing on the example I've got on screen currently at the minute for you. So HLC, yep, good setting to put on. The level you choose with a little slider, you determine how much HLC you want to put onto there. That's entirely up to yourselves. Now, other than that, there's not a lot of other settings that you would really touch on here. If you start messing with the other settings you've got on here, you might start to find you're going to actually spoil the AMPR on here and not actually get an accurate plate read. So the main settings is HLC, and again, you might want to potentially turn your smart sprint light, and then also your exposure time is one that you'll also look at as well. Now at the top there, we've got our OSD, our on-screen display. So where we can put on there, just like a normal conventional camera, your date and time, the name of the camera, you can specify out there. That's entirely up to what you want to. Another good feature though on this camera is here, display tilt angle. So if I tick that to turn it on, that'll appear in the top right-hand corner. And let me just click save on there. So I'm now displaying the tilt angle of the camera. Let's just go to the live view so you get a bigger image and you can see exactly what this is doing now. So we look at the top right-hand corner, and again, there's a slight little wobble in there, which you will get an AMPR camera. It's not entirely accurate, of course. I mean, we're talking 0.1 of a degree, 0.2 of a degree in there. This is telling me this camera is tilted approximately, I would say, what, 4.5 degrees down? Absolutely fine. Now, why do we have to focus on tilt angle? Well, basically, there's a rule of thumb with AMPR. The maximum tilt we can go to is a 30-degree tilt angle down. If we tilt any further down, we're looking too far down on top of the car and we cannot get the plate read correctly. So again, we've got this 30 degree rule that we need to be fully aware of as well. We cannot tilt any further than 30 degrees. Also, while we're on the factor of angles, again, I'll put the image on the screen there, as you can see, we cannot tilt the camera any further than 30 degrees out to the side either. So we've got this 30 degree boundary that we've got to be fully aware of as well as when we actually tilting these cameras or moving them out to the side as well. No more than 30 degrees in any of these situations. Okay, so we've configured sort of the image settings, our on-screen display. You've gone there and made sure that you're tilted angle correctly on the camera. The next thing we need to do now is actually configure the AMPR details themselves. And for that, we go to BCA at the top, our video content analysis. So VCA resource, that is set to road traffic because it's an AMPR camera. Theoretically, you could get this camera to be a smart event camera, which you're doing all your smart deep learning stuff. But again, we're using it for the purpose of AMPR, so that's why it's on road traffic. Your general VSA settings, there's not much you need to do in there unless you want to give the camera a name and camera info. But again, we don't need to bother too much with that one. Road traffic is what we're in particular interested in now. And this is where we set up our road traffic details. So as you can see, it's enabled for vehicle detection, which is great. And then we've got our left border and our right border. We can do multiple lanes, up to two lanes with this camera. Rule of thumb with this one, we're doing multiple lanes. You can only do two lanes if the cars are traveling at less than 30 miles an hour. If they're traveling more than 30 miles an hour, it can only really capture one lane. So again, do bear in mind, you can do multiple lanes, but they have to be moving less than 30 miles an hour in order to do so. So you put your borders in place. Now you can actually, if you wanted to, draw the actual shape of the lane in place, if that's what you actually really wanted to do. But just bear in mind, it is actually a capture zone that we're actually doing. So again, I can draw my left and right borders in place wherever I really wanted to put them. However, for a gated entrance, there's nothing wrong with me actually just doing a parallel box in the scene in this sort of scenario. If I was drawing an actual road area in place, then I might want to actually just do the actual shape of the road itself. But again, in my scenario here, going like this will be absolutely fine because obviously the vehicle's only going to come for that area. Then we've got this blue line as well. This blue line is our triggering line. That is where the plate is going to fall into when the actual capture takes place. So treat it as a line crossing for the license plate itself. Once that plate goes across that line, that's when it tries and gets its capture. Fine, no problem. Now, as you can see here at the bottom of the scene, we've got things like our focus in, focus out as well. We've also got our zoom in and zoom out. Now, this is zoomed in at the minute. If I zoom this back out, that's what the actual thing looks like itself. Now, if I try to do it like this, the problem is that plate will be too small on the scene. So I have actually used a zoom feature to zoom the camera in. In this case, that's the maximum zoom that this camera can actually do. And that will be suffice. Because we've got to make sure that the plate is big enough for the camera to actually read it. We also need to make sure it's not too big on the scene either, because that's going to cause problems as well. So again, use your zoom in and your zoom out to get the right sort of plate size. Use your focus in and focus out as well to actually make sure it's in sharp focus in that area. As we can see at the bottom there, yes, we've got the number of lanes. Country region is European region in the UK. Select mode, we've got city streets, entrance exit or alarm input, so depending on how it's doing it. So again, this is an entrance and exit. I could go with something along these lines. And then obviously I can choose where my capture line goes. And I can say round about there is where I want the plate hit to actually be before it takes a read. Okay. Detection mode. So there's two types of detection mode on these ANPR cameras. By default, it's set to license plate or vehicle, or I can go vehicle priority. So what does that mean? Well, if I go for vehicle priority, what the camera will do, it will go, oh, are you a vehicle, yes or no? Yes, you're a vehicle. Now I'm going to look for your license plate before I take a read. Problem with that is, at nighttime, because we're going to have such a dark scene, the camera will not see a vehicle before it sees a plate. So we may not get a read. So we're going to go with license plate or vehicle. That means it's going to look for a license plate and a vehicle at the same time. So if it sees a plate in the scene, it's going to go, oh, yes, but there's a plate there. And I'm going to also look for potentially a vehicle as well. Below here, we've got the option to remove duplicated plates. So the idea being, if you think someone's going to park in a scene, or maybe it's a barrier where you know a vehicle's going to be actually parked in that line till the barrier opens, what you don't want is the camera going, take a read, take a read, take a read, take a read, because all of a sudden your backend system is going to be spammed with loads of plate hits of the exact same place and you have multiple reads and you don't want that. So if you know the vehicle's going to be parked in the scene, maybe it's parked at a barrier before the barrier opens, you can say, actually, yeah, once you've took a read, don't take another read until, in this case, 4 minutes have elapsed, and then you can read the same plate again. So it means it just won't be the same plate multiple times. So I've got that in there now. I'm just going to click save. That's all done and dusted. It's saying, do I want to reboot the unit? Yes, I do. Let's reboot that camera. And then let's just see the other settings that we've got to do on here. So we're back into the camera now. I just cut out that part of the video. Obviously, you don't just sit there and wait for the camera to reboot. So we've rebooted the camera now. We're back in there. We can see all our settings have saved regarding how we've set this up. Next tab there now is our arming schedule. So what do we want the camera to do when it takes a plate lit? And this is all about the plate hits in regards to allow list, block list, or other list. Now, as you can see by default out of the box, it's set to do everything on everything. this is where you may need to tweak this. So if we look at the allow list, first of all, you can set your schedule for your allow list. The direction of travel, all forward or reverse. And it's currently set to send an email, notify surveillance center, which is the Hike Connect app, upload a file to the memory card on the actual camera if you did put an SD card in there. As you can see, there's two alarm outputs. So this alarm output might be linked to a barrier. So you're saying when it takes a play tip and it's in the, and the vehicle's in the allow list, then it's going to open the barrier. We can even have it to trigger the WeGAN connection, which is obviously for our third-party readers that can go into the camera. So I can just say, well, I don't send an email. I don't need to upload anything to the SD card because I've not put one in there, because usually you would supply an NVR for this to go into and obviously record on there anyway. If I want to trigger an alarm output, yes, I've got one alarm output, which happens to be my barrier. And then do I want to use WeGAN? Well, I'm not using WeGAN, so I can just say, no, I'm not using that. And then click save. That's now saved those settings. What about my block list? So vehicles that are banned or not allowed in my system. Well, I don't send an email because I'm not using that one. I'll allow it coming forward and reverse of both directions. I don't need to upload a file. Trigger alarm output. Well, do I really want the vehicle to open the barrier if it's banned from sight? Well, of course I don't. So I'm going to turn off the alarm output. It might be that alarm output 2 does something else. Maybe triggers an outdoor siren or whatever. It's up to yourselves. But I certainly don't want it opening the barrier. And then I don't need it calling WeGAN either. So then I can save that. So what about vehicles that are not in the allow list and not in the block list? So it's a stranger vehicle, for example. Well, yeah, I want a caption coming to and forward and reverse. I don't need email again. Don't need to upload a file. I'll have notified surveillance center. I don't want them opening the barrier. I don't want it triggering any particular alarm. And I don't need a WeGAN either. So save that there. So the next thing we've got along the top here now is picture. So this is all to do with what the camera's going to actually capture. So the picture type. So it's going to get the, when it says background, that means it's going to get the entire picture, the entire scene that we've had that the camera actually sees. It's also going to capture the license plate close up, so a close up of the actual plate itself, so a full picture, just a close up of the plate. But then I can also choose a third picture, which is of the vehicle itself, which is just a normal picture of the entire vehicle. So I'm going to get three images back. I'm going to get one image, which is going to be for the background, one picture, which is going to be for the actual license plate close up, and the third image, which is going to be the actual vehicle itself. Here we can specify the picture size in kilobytes. 300 kilobytes is fine. You don't want to make that too big because, again, you're going to congest your network. Capture size, yep, 1080p is fine. And then we've got an overlay tick box here. This is telling us where, so when we get our captured image, what we'll have there, we will have a black border at the bottom and it'll have a white text in there. And when that white font area, it's going to have, it could be the device number, it could be the capture time, the direction the vehicle was traveling, the plate number, the camera info, so forth. So depending on what I want to, and I can also change the actual order in which these display on. So I'm just going to save on there. Advanced parameters, there's nothing really much on there. You need to really just tell you about the firmware version for the actual type of AMPR algorithm being used. That's fine. And allow list and block list. So in the allow list and block list, we've got a few options we can do. We can actually import or export an actual list or an Excel document off the camera. So if I export an actual Excel document off here, what this will allow me to do is in an Excel spreadsheet, I can then put in there my vehicle number, my plate number, and then I can put in there 0 if it's block list, 1 if it's allow list, what date it starts from, and the end date in there. And then once I've saved that, if I was choosing it to do it that way, I could then import that list and then bum, 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 they will all appear in that list just there. That's quite useful if you've got a lot of vehicles already on a database and you export that off there. You can import them in batches. That makes it very useful. As you can see, it can accept up to 10,000 license plates. If you've only got a couple, however, it's very nice and simple. Just click on add and you can type in your vehicle plates in there should you wish. And is it allow list, block list, which your list is going to be in. End date and start date and so on, and then list will appear in there. So that's majority settings all set up now. However, there are other things we need to bear in mind. So I'm just going to go to live view now to have a look at this. We might have some vehicles coming and going based on the time of day it currently is at the moment. One thing to be aware of is obviously the plate size. So when we get a vehicle plate that's in the scene, we need to make sure that that actual plate is of a certain size. And we do recommend a minimum width of 130 pixels. But how do we count that? Well, bottom right corner there, we have our pixel counter. That allows me to draw a box in the scene like this. And therefore, if I go to 130 wide, you can see that at the bottom of the scene. Oh, try and get it. There we go. That's about 130. As we can see, so long as our plate is wider than that, that should give us a fairly accurate read. As we see there at the bottom, it says there that the width for that one was 133 pixels wide. So again, when you are testing it, if you're not getting reads or not, usually get someone to park into the scene or go to the scene where it is and just check that the actual plate width is sufficient. So how do we know if it's taking a read or not? Well, at the top there, we've got our smart display. So if I go into smart display, this will then show me all the vehicles that are coming and going within the scene. So what I'll do, I'm going to jump in my car now, drive it through, and we'll just take a look and see what sort of plate hits we get. So as you can see, my vehicle driving in, I've got the details at the top right there. It's got my plate number. It's got a picture of the vehicle itself. It says the moving direction was forward. It was in the other list, i.e. so it wasn't actually... oh, there's another car coming there. So if I just click on the car itself, let's get some more details. There we go. So we've got the time it was captured at, the plate number itself, moving direction was forward. The plate number itself is actually there as well. The camera number, the capture time. So we're getting all the information there about that camera and about, sorry, about the camera, but the car itself, as we see. And that was obviously quite an accurate capture.
So there we go, everyone. Hopefully you found that useful. The 7 Series ANPR camera with deep learning in there. I'll put the link in below for the actual product itself if you are interested in it. Hopefully you found it useful as well, how to actually set that camera up accurately and get accurate plate read as you saw. As always, guys, don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Do hit that like button and also that bell icon. That will alert you when we upload any new videos.